This interview is part of the Living Legends collection of the Oklahoma Historical Society. It is an interview with Miss Anna Picklum of El Reno, Oklahoma. Interviewed on June 24, 1971 by Bernard Kellner.
This is Bernard Kellner of Oklahoma City interviewing Miss Anna Picklum, a graduate nurse,
registered,
on her experience over the many years in her life and old El Reno Sanitarium, which takes place in El Reno, Oklahoma, 24th of June, 1971. I give you Mrs. Smith.
Oh. I was born in St. Louis, Missouri. My people were in the lumber business, and we went west to Colby, Kansas, later to Minnesota, where my father died. My mother married again, and in 1901, she came to Chickasha, Oklahoma. I graduated from the Chickasha High School, and in 1914, we came to El Reno. In 1916, I entered nurse's training in the El Reno Sanitarium. I think that's enough of mine. Now you want me to go on to the hospital. What the hospital is.
Let's take one, give a brief summary of your training to be a nurse.
The El Reno Hospital was built by Dr. J. A. Hackett in 1902. Several months after the hospital opened, a training school for nurses was established. This was the first training school in the state. It was the second hospital in the state. A hospital at McAllister had been founded several years earlier by the Sisters of Mercy after mine disaster. The first training school, first years of the training school, only 2 years was required for training. Later, 3 years. All lectures were given by doctors. See, I think it'd be nice to mention a doctor, don't you? All right. Now, this is during my time, of course. Dr. John A. Hackett lectured in obstetrics, nursing ethics, and mental diseases. Thomas Adderholt, M.D. and M.S., lectured in anatomy and physiology. James C. Riley, M.D., lectured in materia medica and fever nursing. W.J. Murray, M.D., pathologist, bacteriology. L.A. Curry, professor of pathology and history, and associate dean of the School of Medicine, consulting pathologist. Phil S. Herod, M.D., oculist and aurist, lecturer in ears, eye, nose, and throat. T.F. Clifford, B.D.S., lecturer in oral surgery and hygiene. Dr. Hatchett taught obstetrics and gave the same examination to interns at the medical school as he did to the El Reno nurses. The El Reno nurses were rated higher than those of the interns, which pleased the old doctor very much. 100 doctors brought patients to El Reno Sanitarium in those years from western Oklahoma. A letter every other day to the local doctors. This kept the family informed. Doctors and sometimes their wives were guests overnight. Trays were served to members of the family if they so desired. The cost was 35 cents per meal. This money went to the nurses, as it made extra work for them. With this money, a piano was bought for the senior nurses' home. There were 101 nurses graduated from the El Reno Sanitarium. The school was closed at the request of the Alumni Association in 1929, and today, all are retired. About one third has passed to the great beyond. Now I don't know what else you want.
Miss Picklum, would you mind giving us the rundown on personal requirements of the nurse as to time, dress, wages, and personal conduct in general?
Student nurses were given 3 months probation. During this time, they could wear any washable dress. After 3 months, they were given their cap and were required to wear a uniform, which was a blue gray gingham that came within a few inches of the floor. The aprons were the length of the dress and were made of mud of a sheeting 2 yards wide. A bib, collars, and cuffs completed the end. At the end of 1 year, the girl received one stripe on her black velvet on her cap. The second year, she received 2 stripes, and the third year, 3. This was, in a way, a disadvantage because the patients took advantage of the stripes. They'd say, we want the nurse that has the most stripes. The day nurses came on duty at 7 o'clock. They arose at 6 o'clock and straightened up their rooms and had breakfast before coming on duty. They worked until 7 o'clock at night with 2 hours off in the afternoon unless there was an emergency, and then no hours was given. 4 hours was given on Sunday afternoon, if possible. The compensation given in those days was $5 a month for the first year, $7.50 for the second, and $10 for the third year. Registered nurses at that time that had completed their training got $25 a week.
Did they furnish their own meals, or were they furnished meals and lodging?
Did they furnish what? Food and lodging was furnished. There were 3 different residences, one for each year of training, and they were comfortably furnished.
Did I understand that at that time there was some sort of fee splitting among doctors?
Yes, sir, there was. A great deal of nursing was done in the homes in those days, out in the rural districts. And the conveniences were very inadequate. I know at several places that I went to myself after I graduated, I would take my bath in the evening, having set a tub of water out in the sun, and the wife would help me carry it into the kitchen, and I would pin my apron in my uniform, or my uniform, over the windows, and she would watch the patient while I took my bath.
Miss Picklum, you had what I presume a super nurse, at least a well-recognized one, Miss Ida Ferguson. Will you tell?
I thought I mentioned her right at the beginning of the first day. I think I did mention it, but I'll give it again. Miss Ida Ferguson graduated in 1905 and was the first nurse to complete her complete training at El Reno Sanitarium. Two other nurses had partial training elsewhere and graduated here. Oh, yeah. And I would like to say in this connection that two nurses died of typhoid fever while in training. They broke their technique in some way and contracted the disease. Also, another nurse, just about ready to graduate several years later, died of a...
I believe there's some more you can say about Miss Hall, or Miss Ferguson, rather. Did she not become a member of the Hall of Fame in 1937? And as a World War One.
Miss Ferguson was later admitted to the Hall of Fame as a result of her being the first graduate nurse in Oklahoma, and as a charter member of the Oklahoma State Nurses Association. She served in World War I. She volunteered to serve in World War I, but took flu and was retired after 6 weeks.
This ends the interview conducted by Mr. Kellner with Miss Anna Picklum, registered nurse. Miss Kellner has a postscript. Miss Kellner has a postscript. Will you please give us more information as to your schooling over at Peabody and in training for advancement in your profession? And did you not tell me that you worked something like 16 years as a representative of the Crippled Children's Hospital? And will you tell us one experience that you had at Clinton, Oklahoma?
Answering your question, I took my public health training at Peabody College, Nashville, Tennessee. I had done my rural field work in that county. I think it was called Franklin County. I'd done my city field work in Birmingham, Alabama. That at that time I was in the last time I was employed by the Oklahoma Crippled Children's Commission and worked for them for 16 years. I also had courses in orthopedics, in Western Reserve, and in the Children's Hospital of Los Angeles. During 1920, this is a side trip, I made the cordel for the Red Cross. In September 1920, the Red Cross Division at St. Louis wired me that the Red Cross chapter in Cordell wanted a nurse to measure children and put on some hygiene classes during the fair in that city. I was instructed to take the train from El Reno to Clinton and there to take an auto bus overland. I was to stop at the Iron Hotel where the chapter would pay my expenses. When I drove up to the large frame ramshackle building, my heart sank. I asked the driver, is this the Iron Hotel? And he replied that it was. I asked him if it was the best hotel in town, and he said it was the only one. I entered a lobby at one end of which was arranged the wash pans and roller towels for the local people to use before eating their meal. I was shown to what was supposed to be the best room in the hotel, the front southeast room. Before I could make my toilet, I had to polish the mirror and clean the wash bowl. Dinner was served in a large dining room, boarding house fashion. I do not remember the food. I suppose it was all right. But there were two persons stationed at either end of the table with long leafy branches with which they chewed the flies from the food. The second evening of my stay, I retired rather early and was rudely awakened at 11:30 by the cry of a woman saying, "For God's sake, don't shoot." A man replied, "I'll shoot if that rat don't come out." There was other conversation which I don't at present remember, but it dawned on me that the walls were rather thin and that a stray bullet might enter my room. Why I thought a feather pillow would stop a bullet, or why I thought I might be stuck in the middle, I do not know. But I reached under my pillow and pulled the pillow out and laid it over my abdomen. I should have said the woman I didn't. After considerable commotion, I heard heavy footsteps of the law coming upstairs and then going back again. I peered out of the window to see the culprit being led to the calaboose between two officers. I don't know when I went to sleep again, but when I woke in the morning, the first thing I saw was a rope over the window, which was in those days used as a fire escape. Had I noticed it the night before, I certainly would have gone out of that window.